thank you very much. So thank you all for coming. I will try and explain this sort of rather odd title, Deconstructing Child as Method. So this is a sort of dual function event, because what I want to do is to describe something of my own trajectory from someone who was involved in offering critiques of developmental psychology to my current work, where I'm formulating something that I'm calling Child as Method. And both of these are examples of what I would see as a politically engaged psychology of childhood and education. In what's common to both of these projects of deconstructing developmental psychology and of Child as Method is a project to situate, to embed and understand our constructions of childhood within, I put here, wider psychic and political economies. By political economies, I mean social, material, economic circumstances in which children's lives are lived, but also the psychic economies, the meanings, the ideas about childhood that that we as adults hold about children, and that children come to hold about themselves as children too. And attending to these constructions, I think, can offer us ways of thinking differently, enriching our understandings of critical pedagogy in ways that I think invite us as adults to rethink our pedagogies as well as for children. So today is a dual function event in the sense that I'm also kind of launching the third edition of my book, Deconstructing Developmental Psychology. The first edition was in 1994, the second in 2008. Hello, do come in. The third, well, now. And we do have copies of the book, special price today of £23, because that's the price I can buy them at. Hello, come in. And Saba over here has copies of the books if you want it, or there's a leaflet where you can get a discount, but unfortunately the price is in dollars, but we can tell you how much that really is in pounds. Anyway, I will move on to talk about what I mean by this shift from deconstruction to child as method. What I was doing in the third edition of Deconstructing Developmental Psychology, well, in all the editions, but now it's updated, is offering a critical reading of the forms, functions, practices, and institutional relations that developmental psychology participates in, contributes to, and reflects. And that broad sense I put fulfilled by, but I mean it in all those ways. And also, during that process of writing that book, and via my work in women's studies, which Daniela was also a part of many years ago, I have had a trajectory that's moved from teaching psychology exclusively to teaching feminist theory, to now being here in Manchester Institute of Education, and becoming much more engaged in this new discipline that has arisen that is called childhood studies. And as Kevin said the last time I spoke here in one of the Sarah Fielden lectures 2 years ago, 3 years ago, I was talking about the work of Frantz Fanon and as a theorist to help us think about childhood. And now where I've gone since then is to develop that line of thinking, now using the ideas from cultural studies written by a Taiwanese scholar, Chen, who formulated an approach he calls Asia as Method. But I'm taking his ideas in a broader sense and applying them to formulate what I'm trying to call something like Child as Method, as an approach to analysing the political effects of constructions of childhood and also their psychological or psychic ones. So that's what I'm going to be focusing on today. And what I'm going to do is to take an example that must be very much in our minds, given that Article 50 will be triggered next week. Taking an example focused around Brexit, and I'm going to analyse some coverage around Brexit through a critical reading of an essay by someone called Octave Manoni. It's an essay that was first published in 1963 in French, only translated in 2003 into English. Now, what that does is, perhaps unusually for MIE, is to bring psychoanalytic theory into the frame of our analysis and discussions around critical pedagogies. Only I'm using psychoanalysis here not only as a clinical practice, clinical, you know, to do with helping people, individuals or small groups, with their personal difficulties, their distress, but as a social theory. Oop. And I'm going to be using it critically. As you will see, I will be making some critical comments about the roles and functions of psychoanalysis too. And what I want to do through this reading of Manoni's essay is to show, to illustrate something of what we might gain from looking at the ways in which ideas about children, including our commitments to children, function within wider political practices. Now, in this case, I'm going to be talking about the structure of racist discourse or racist forms of belief. But I think this approach probably goes much further, though I'm rather preoccupied with racism at the moment, and in a way that's what motivates the whole of my analysis today. But I want to use this analysis, this critical reading of Manoni's essay, as an example that I hope may also have wider applications in thinking about anti-racist and other kinds of pedagogies of solidarity. So the key point I'm going to make here is that our culturally embedded and constructed pedagogies that involve the deception of children. So we have everyday pedagogies around children and childhood where we deceive them all the time, and that this deception underlies forms of adherence or commitment to socially shared convictions, that is, convictions that we all share, that are recognised to be untrue. I know this is a bit of a mouthful. I'll be going over this in various ways, how cultural pedagogies involving the deception of children underlie forms of adherence to socially shared convictions that are recognised to be untrue. And I'm going to take racism as the example, and through that try and explain how a lot of racist discourse works. And also, I think, because this is a psychoanalytic kind of reading, a social psychoanalytic reading, try and account for some of the peculiar qualities about racism that it seems to be so difficult to challenge, so easy for people to deny that it was just a joke or they didn't mean it, and all the paradoxical ways in which challenge to racist ideas seems to withstand the confrontation with contradiction. So, now to Brexit. And of course, I'm not only talking about Brexit, but as we remember around the referendum, Donald Trump promised Brexit +++, and that seems to be what he is indeed doing. And of course, around Brexit, and since the referendum in June, there seems to be a context of apparent tolerance of racism and xenophobia in lots of ways. And the puzzle, then, that I'm trying to get at here is the way in which racist discourse seems to be so resilient, we might say, or intransigent to confrontation with contradiction and inconsistency. And again, this I'm going to take as a specific example of this trope I've outlined again here, how cultural pedagogies involving the deception of children underlie forms of adherence to socially shared convictions that are recognised to be untrue. Now, some of you know I walk to work many days of the week, and I listen to the radio, and I heard, hello, come in, Uting. I heard these extracts from a sort of mini-series that was called Brexit Street. I don't know if other people, any of you, heard this on Radio 4. So first of all, it was broadcast in July 2016, and then extracts from it were on the news programme PM. And this programme interviewed people about why they'd voted and what their thoughts were about Britain, and it was set in a Brexit Street, it was called, was set in a deprived area of England that was called, a little digging around in some of the online commentary, Thornaby in Teesdale. And there was a lot of discussion actually about how representative Thornaby in Teesdale and this Brexit Street was of opinion in that area. And I think there is a whole story here about the vilification of the working class as being more racist than everybody else that needs to be thought about in relation to the coverage of these kinds of issues. But and I will sort of set that at aside for now, but certainly identify class as a really big issue underlying this whole discussion. And I'm going to show you some extracts here, and this is my transcription from listening online and writing it down. I hope it's accurate enough. But it was the contradictions that I heard that made me really think and want to find some means of trying to understand it. And it's like this. So, and Mark, who is identified as being 52 and an unemployed carpet layer, he says things like, I know this. And then there's a pause. But obviously, they still take up housing when the interviewer is saying, you know. And then Carol, who is presented as being someone, she has children, she cares for children, she does lots of good work, she's a volunteer in a food bank in a local church, talking about immigrants now and the Brexit question of immigration as a feature of the Brexit vote. As long as they're willing to pay into our country and support and work in our country, then I don't see a great problem. But if they're just coming over for our money and our income, .. Okay? And then later on, with examples about with the same interviewee, the interviewer says, "But as asylum seekers, they're not allowed to work at the moment." And Carol says, "Yeah, I understand. Yes, yes." And a pause. They should be made to pay back a little each week for the resources they're getting to prove that they're not just here just to take, but also to give. So there's a kind of acknowledgement of what the interviewer says, and then a discounting. And this is what led me to read and come to Octave Manoni's essay that is called "I Know Well, But All the Same," because that's what this "yeah, I understand, yes, yes," pause and then carrying on seems to me to take the form of "I know well, but all the same." So a little bit about Manoni. So Octave Manoni was French of Corsican parentage. He was a philosopher, a teacher, and later trained as a Lacanian psychoanalyst. Before he trained as a psychoanalyst, he worked as a colonial administrator for 20 years in Madagascar, which is where he or from that experience, he wrote a book, Prospero and Caliban, The Psychology of Colonization, which is the book, in fact, that if you do any searches around Manoni, you'll mainly find out how much Fanon really, really disagreed with him. And interestingly, he, as well as living and working in Madagascar for that period of time, in the 1920s, he also taught in Martinique, Martinique being the country where Fanon grew up. And even more interestingly, he taught in the school that Fanon went to and taught Fanon's mentor, Aimé Césaire. So there's a kind of, it's something that isn't really picked up in a lot of the English language literature, but there are those close connections between Manoni and Fanon. And I will be trying to retrieve, a better Manoni through the reading of him with Fanon rather than Fanon against Manoni. So that's Manoni, who he was, and he wrote this essay, I Know Well, But All the Same. which, as I said, was first translated in 2003, translated in a book that was very much taking up political applications of psychoanalytic theory to talk about ideology, and particularly in relation to the question of belief through the psychoanalytic understanding of fetishism, taking our beliefs, our social beliefs, our ideologies, as a kind of fetish, as a way in which we fixate on things to cover over other forms of lack or insecurity. But in all this discussion about I Know Well But All the Same, an ideology that has surrounded the take-up of Manoni's essay, particularly through the work of Žižek, there's actually very little discussion about what he says about the role of the child in this essay. And I think that what he says about the child or children is pretty interesting. However, and I'm going to tell you about that, but I'll also describe how he too is subject to some of the effects that he describes. And in that sense, you could say that what Manoni exemplifies is a sort of pedagogy of failure that in fact people who have discussed Fanon's work have described as part of Fanon's own approach. And I'm happy to talk in some more detail about the pedagogy of failure later, but I'm not going to say a lot more about it now, though I will draw attention to some of Manoni's own complicities. So, Manoni is talking about this trope, I Know Well But All the Same, and he talks about children and the gullibility of children, or the constructed gullibility of children, and he uses this word gulls that I'd never heard before. I'd heard of gullibility, but not gulls. And what he does is focuses on the position in relation to knowledge, or rather lack of knowledge, that we give children. And he says, children are a kind of prop for the adult's belief. In all societies, beliefs are based on the credulity of children. So he makes that statement really clearly, and he gives lots and lots of examples. There's only one example from his own clinical practice, all that is about anything to do with a psychoanalytical sort of analyst analysand practice. But he gives lots of examples that come from anthropological, ethnographic, literary examples, popular culture, everyday social practices. He talks about you know, how we read horoscopes and we don't believe them, but still we feel pleased if it's positive. That's a kind of example of I Know Well But All the Same. I know well that, you know, it's rubbish, but I still enjoy a positive prediction. And Manoni talks about the status of a mistake. He calls it a gaffe, a mistake that he makes. And I'm going to describe that mistake in some detail, which is his clinical example. So what his argument is about the societal structuring of the disavowal of belief. So the question of belief, he says, is it can be connected to societal symbols or fetishes, like flags and national symbols. And the disavowal of that belief, that you say, you repudiate that belief, but still it remains. The disavowal changes the reality whilst repressing the memory of the disavowal. And he suggests that this accounts for the strange or anomalous subjective orientation that's produced by these kinds of disavowed beliefs, beliefs that are disavowed, but then somehow some element remains, which is like the I know well, but all the same. He says, one finds oneself torn between an impression of extreme banality and a powerful feeling of strangeness. And the long example he gives, or one of the long examples, is an ethnographic example that he takes from a text that he says will be well known to the French reading public. It's it's an autobiographical account by a Hopi Indian. This is a Mexican indigenous minority about initiation rites. And Taliyevska writes about how traumatic it was that in this cultural ritual where where people dressed up as demons and had to be appeased with food, that he nearly recognized, he almost recognized that these people were his grandparents and aunts and uncles. He almost recognized it, and then his mother kind of distracted him and, you know, did something so that he could just ward away that recognition. And Manoni links this traumatic moment to Freud's analysis of castration anxiety. And I'm taking castration here, I mean, I do subscribe to some psychoanalytic ideas, but in a social sense. And indeed, as also Freud did, because Freud analyzed castration anxiety as, and this is Manoni's quote from Freud, the model for the kinds of panic that erupt in later life when people are suddenly overwhelmed by the feeling that throne and altar are in danger. So the idea is that these big ideas of patriotism, nationalism, our belief and religious belief somehow are connected to some very early experiences of a sense of lack or insecurity within ourselves. And according to sort of Manoni's Freudian reading here, this is tied to the establishment of the superego as of the kind in the ways that would be explicitly structured into cultural initiation rites of the kind that Taleyevsa is writing about. And he says it also, and all but indiscernibly, recalls the moment when belief shedding its imaginary form is symbolized through cultural practices sufficiently to lead on to faith, that is, to a commitment. So that brings us then directly to this question of deceiving children, because as Manoni writes about how when we grow up we learn that some of the things we were told were not true, but nevertheless we know that still younger children have to be deceived. And he says that it's very important that these younger, so-called non-initiated children continue to be taken in by the imposture. They continue to be deceived, and they're central to maintaining that very deception or myth. He says, one might say that the children are a kind of prop for the adult's belief, and says, in all societies, beliefs are based first and foremost on the credulity of children. He says, and this is really important observation, I think, I do not think we've paid enough attention to the question of what transpires when in our societies an adult feels the need to deceive a child about Santa Claus, the stork, where babies come from, and so on, to the point that she sometimes fears that throne and altar, to use Freud's expression, will be endangered if someone suggests disabusing the victim. Now it's kind of interesting here that he uses the female pronoun she. We might want to think about that. Maybe it's something to do with who spends most time with children. But that the perpetrator here is a she and the victim is the child. And it's interesting that he portrays the deceived child as being a victim, but they are the victim of this deception in this case. And he says, and again, I think this is important, in synchronic perspective, the child can, as someone who is both present and an outsider, play a non-negligible role by assuming, as he does amongst the Hopis, the burden of our beliefs after disavowal. So it's something about the position of the child who is both present and an outsider, who comes to represent the ideal typical believer. And he says, and here I think we have to remember that Manoni married a woman, Maud, who is the founder of a very innovative kind of psychoanalytic practice with children, so he knew what he was talking about. He says, if psychoanalysis has delivered us of the myth of children's purity and innocence, and of course psychoanalysis has by the ideas about childhood sexuality and so on, so children are far from pure and innocent, or only being pure and innocent, but it has not gone very far in analysing the function of this myth. Infant credulity helps us disavow our own beliefs. So we don't have to say we believe these things because the children believe them. And even he goes on to say that there's no need for the person, in order to sustain this kind of elaborate myth, for children to be in the room or to have even encountered children, because it's the symbolic function held by the child and children that enables this cultural practice to be maintained and continue. Okay, so I think, just to say what Manoni's central claims are then before I move on, that we have a need to make children innocent in order to shore up the cracks in our own insecure beliefs. Which means, as Manoni says, that the myth of children's purity and innocence is only a way of talking about their credulity. And at the same time, this credulity is something that has been elaborately manufactured, that you know, the question of what functions it serves for children is one, but it certainly serves a lot of purposes for adults. And the key points here then, I hope I'm not labouring the point too much, but that the maintenance of an adult position relies on the deception of the child or children. And this is a knowing overlooking of things that are untrue, that are warranted or supported by some kinds of understandings that are presumed shared. So, you know, we all know that there isn't a Father Christmas, but we have to kind of keep that story going because of the children. That's at its crudest form, but it takes more implicit forms too. So that the indulgence accorded children relies on the deception of children in order to preserve intact certain kinds of social fantasies. This is the purity and innocence of children. And in that sense, we could say that the deception of children is institutionalized and works to secure the place of belief for the adult, not for the child. So the implications here, I think, are quite extensive. I mean, one line of argument would be to expand, to elaborate what's at stake in this attributed innocence of children. And another is that it complicates the position of the child that Manoni describes as being both present and an outsider. And I think this is very interesting to think about in relation to projects of participation, social inclusion of children. And of course, the question of knowledge and agency. So I'm going to come back to those, but first of all, I want to return to Manoni's text a little bit to see how this position of the child works in relation to other kinds of power relations, in particular to Manoni's so-called clinical mistake. And he calls it a mistake, and he's quite coy about that. But I'm going to use it to disclose, to show how, in a way, this reveals something about the exclusions of psychoanalysis and Manoni's own dynamics of deception and self-deception. And this is the text which is worth looking at, you know, and I'll read it to you to think about in some detail. This is his clinical mistake. Someone who had taken a call for me had distorted the caller's name, making it sound like that of a black poet from whom I had been expecting a friendly visit. I was busy, so I asked that the poet be given the message to come see me, I think this is the American translation, to come and see me as soon as he could. We would have the time, I added, for a pre-dinner drink. The person who was to open the door was informed of all this. The doorbell rang, and a bit surprised despite himself, he came to tell me, he being the person who was to open the door, we presume, he came to tell me, Monsieur, it's not a Negro, it's a client of yours. And what happens next is that the client comes to the couch and says, yes, I know that you were joking about that pre-dinner drink on the phone, but all the same, I'm terribly pleased. Almost in the same breath, this is a quote from Manoni, almost in the same breath, he added, especially because my wife thinks you meant it. Okay, so lots of things here. And of course, I want to take a feminist post-colonial reading of this, because we've got a lot going on around class, property relations, gender relations, and more, all within this narrative. We have the someone who had taken a call for me, you know, implying a whole architecture of the French middle class household with doors and corridors and big spaces and servants who seemed to carry a bit of the can for this mistake in Manoni's implication. And the person who was to open the door as well. So what are we to think about the gender, class, and cultural assumptions implied here but not commented on? And secondly, in terms of unanalyzed assumptions, the whole monsieur, it's not a Negro, it's a client of yours, is never analyzed in Manoni's text for the assumptions about racialization and which kinds of people are assumed to be being clients doing psychoanalysis. And in reading this, I mean, I suppose what struck me reading it is that that it encapsulates the whole history and indeed the current context of the large marginalization of black and minority ethnic people from the theory and practice of psychoanalysis, typically within conventional understandings of psychological mindedness and so on, presumed to be not ideal, typical psychoanalytic subjects, or in not suitable for psychoanalysis at all. I mean, obviously, that's a varied picture and has changed quite a lot. But somehow, in that presumption that it's a Negro, not a client, there is those sets of assumptions. And then we have the attributed or imposed credulity of the woman. You know, I'm so pleased that my wife thinks the pre-dinner drink invitation is true. And so we have a whole set of socio-political and intra-psychic, you know, sort of personally felt investments that rely upon particular sexed, generational, classed, racialized, and gendered arrangements. And so that this thing about the child, the position of the child, can only function in relation to all, in intersectional relationship with all these others. And that's, I think, a key point I would want to make. So this trope I know well, but all the same, through this, Manoni is identifying the psychic structures involved in producing commitment to false beliefs, the kind of false beliefs that in the Brexit Street were about immigrants taking our jobs, even when they're not allowed to work. It's patently a false belief because the interviewee says, yes, I know, but still carries on, saying, anyway, but anyway. And these beliefs produce, include the kind of anxious commitment we have to what Freud called throne and altar, but what we might see as nationalism and religious commitment. And in the Brexit Street mini-series, there were lots of these kinds of examples of that anxious commitment, stories of come Christmas we'd be having parties in each other's houses, the sort of mourning and lost nostalgia of a community that is no more. For some reason, it is no more. And demands that our money should be spent in our country, and we want Britain to be great again. And we heard all of this, you know, endlessly after June, didn't we? So Manoni, it seems, is subject to some of those same sets of assumptions that are embedded in and maintaining these gendered, generational, racialized and classed assumptions, which include the adult superiority over children, men over women, the master of the house and his servants, and of course and remember that Manoni wrote this book, Prospero and Caliban, about the psychology of colonization, the developed over the primitive. And that's reflected specifically in this idea that the Negro is not portrayed as somebody who could have been a possible client. So in that sense, we could say that Manoni is subject to the very dynamic that he describes, in the sense that he can't quite bring into question exactly what the processes he's identifying relies upon. And in that sense, he's actually doing exactly what he's writing about, like the Brexiteers. He knows well, but all the same. And, you know, we could end the story there and say, well, you know, so Manoni knows well, but all the same, and let's discount his theory because he's subject to it too. But we are all subject to aspects of these dynamics. And in a sense, I would say, in terms of this pedagogy of failure, that it invites the need for critical reflexivity. So I would say that Manoni's analysis is useful in the sense that it prompts us to think more closely and carefully about the alignments between the disempowerment of women, which you know, would be psychoanalytically described as a form of symbolic castration, but we could say socially is the social-cultural and historical disempowerment of women, and the institutional imperatives in the deception of children and the imposed innocence of children, and in turn helping us to reflect on what investments we have in the generational order on which they rely. This concept of generational order is one that's come through from childhood studies in the last 20, 30 years, as social, a relationship not simply of chronological age, but of social status. And so we can then think about how the fabrication of these false beliefs in certain kinds of differences, differences between the primitive and modern or developed thought, how they work alongside and intersect with, they necessarily also involve and require and configure in particular ways other social axes of inequality and relationship around class and gender. So we saw this with the servants whose job it was to open the door or to answer the telephone, as well as the attributed credulity, or the credulity attributed to the wife about the drink. Well, so now I want to go back to Fanon in my remaining time with Manoni. So this pedagogy of failure is discussed in some accounts of Fanon's work. And I'm drawing attention to Manoni's mistake here as an example of that, but also how it invites us to bring these other, the intersectional analysis into focus in the discussion about the credulity of the, or attributed credulity of the child. A pedagogy of failure is one that where we're not asking for complete knowledge or omnipotence or mastery, but working with partiality, as the feminist methodologists put it, in the double sense of being situated, perspectival, but also not claiming to have a complete perspective. And elsewhere I've tried to explore from a close reading of some of Fanon's therapeutic work how in his clinical practice Fanon practiced this pedagogy of failure in the sense of leaving space for his analysands, for the people he was working with, to make their own decisions in an ethical political practice of enabling them, and if you like, empowering them to take their own decisions and take forward their own projects rather than telling them what to do. Some of his other writings, he was very programmatic, but elsewhere he was much more open to enabling others. And so here we have Fanon and we have Manoni alongside each other. Now we can reread the position of the child by putting Fanon and Manoni together. As I said earlier, Fanon roundly critiqued Manoni's representation of black people's psychic and mental life and psychopathologies too. But in this later essay, the 1963, I know well but all the same, I think we can use that analysis that Manoni provides to have a clearer understanding, really, of Fanon's reading of and claims about the child and childhood. Now, one of the interesting things, if you've read Black Skin, White Masks, Fanon's first book, is that at the beginning of the book and at the end of the book, he uses the same quotation from Nietzsche, which is, the tragedy of the man is that he was once a child. And again, I haven't seen a lot of comment on the vast corpus of Fanonian studies about this. But I think this is quite interesting to sit alongside Manoni's analysis, where we can see that Fanon isn't necessarily making claims about an authentic timeless childhood, but rather mobilizing this Manoni's analysis to see the position of the child as a specifically invested construction, a construction that we have made to secure certain societal and as well as intrapsychic and interpersonal relations. And again, remembering that Manoni wasn't only talking about these sort of intrapsychic dynamics in the psychoanalytic consulting room, but using Freud's analysis to connect them to social beliefs like throne and altar, or as we might say now, nation and fundamental British values. So, returning now to Brexit Street, children figure there too. I've talked about the adults, but we have the children who start off in a position of innocence. So in the scene setting, the narrator talks about the little children playing tag in the sunshine, which I think we would understand as a sort of saying, this is a nice, safe area where children can play out. And of course, also at the same time, confirming the innocence of children. And, you know, this is confirmed by people talking about the area as being nice, very nice, says Wayne, the landscape gardener. But then there are other accounts that come forward about how, particularly from Peter, who is the only Bremaine interviewee in this story. He's an unemployed, he has depression, so he's off work, and he's the carer for his children. And as he is unwrapping the chocolate biscuits for his children, he's describing how worried he is about children harassing the immigrants who live next door, and painting swastikas on their walls and giving them a lot of abuse. And Peter says, we all know where that leads, and it doesn't go anywhere good. So let's think about where all this takes us in terms of our understandings of perhaps children's rights, responsibility, questions of agency. We have the children's innocence moving around to culpability. That's odd. And even Mark, who you heard before, the unemployed carpet layer, aged 52, he shakes his head in disgust at the abuse that the immigrants have suffered. And he says, the kids here have decided to terrorize them. They're just children. They don't know any better. They're just brainwashed by their parents, who are ignorant. So now it's the parents who are ignorant. But let's think again about how Manoni talked about disavowal as an explanation about how this kind of racism works. He says, not only is the experience not eradicated, so the traumatic experience of the belief, you know, the belief being challenged, it is ineradicable. It leaves an indelible mark. What is eradicated is the memory of the experience. And he says, something of the order of belief had to have subsisted in order to be recognizable despite its transformation. So in terms of this, I know well, but all the same, the but all the same is not unconscious, but it just indicates something that a distancing that goes on. But all the same, I know well it's not true, but all the same, we can say it, we say it consciously, but somehow we're at the same time moving away from that belief without denying it. And yet that belief has changed the reality, Manoni says, after Freud, that creates a kind of territory of knowledge that is kind of unknown, but also known at the same time, that makes it particularly difficult to contest. And if this seems complicated, what's really interesting about this is that the origins of all of this is tied to the deception of children. So something else that Manoni says may help us think again about the position of children on Brexit Street. He says, children in their ignorance can serve as a support for the disavowed belief of adults. And this leads Manoni to the conclusion that it's not the young Hopi, in the example given, it's not the young Hopi who's responsible for the fact that he's been deceived, but the adults. He, the young Hope I, is objectively deceived. His subjectivity does not yet take any part in the matter. So I think the application of this argument would be that the Brexit Street adults have chosen to deceive themselves through this process of disavowal, and have so produced this state of affairs. But in a way, the children have been fed this belief that secures the adults' belief. And then there's a question then about, you know, how responsible are they for their own racist actions or beliefs, given that alongside countering the myth of children's innocence, which Manoni says arises as an effect of the need to render the child both present and an outsider, but there's also, you know, a different position for the child because the children have been objectively deceived. They haven't chosen to deceive themselves. They have been objectively deceived, he says. So we could ask, does this make children less accountable or responsible for their actions, whether taken as the consequences of or the motivations for their actions? That's one direct reading, you know, application we could make from this analysis. Or how do we understand this claim that their subjectivities, you know, haven't taken, or we might want to dispute Manoni's claim that they their subjectivity has taken no part in the matter, but somehow it's maybe not as much as the adults. And I suppose, where would that go? That could take us into a kind of quantitative legal responsibility argument that is really quite beyond what I could talk about tonight, but I think we have to come back and think, well, all of this is important to think about in relation to the extent to which we consider children as being part of or not part of the socio-cultural processes to which they're subjected. And indeed also how what we are subjected to becomes something that we take in and becomes part of our subjectivity, but also how the objective becomes subjectified. So, coming back again to Fanon and Manoni, curiously, right at the end of Black Skin, White Masks, he says the position of the child is, it's a very straight, interesting formulation, is clotted. He is drowned in contingency. Well, Manoni, in a sense, reflecting that kind of attention to contingency, he talks about the child being subjected to the neurotic reactions of those around him. Now, Fanon, Fanon ends Black Skin, White Masks with a huge humanist call to transcend racialized categories. It's an appeal to all of us. He says, the Negro is not any more than the white man. But this call, because of this claim about the tragedy of the man, it's that he was once a child, is in a sense secured through an appeal to a notion of childhood. But it's a notion of childhood that is both general and particular. And we might also think about what both these theorists had to say about education. So Manoni, in his earlier book, Prospero and Caliban, notes, he says, whatever one's favourite educational system, the most important thing to do is to save children from the neurotic reactions of the people around them. That's what education can do. It can simply be a reiteration of those neurotic reactions. And he's thinking particularly of what we try and prevent children from knowing. And he points to the role of the work children do, the active role in warding off those neurotic reactions of others. Fanon, of course, had a much broader educational project in changing the world. As a revolutionary theorist, he says, we shall see that another solution is possible. It implies a restructuring of the world. Of course, he did have very specific things to say about the damaging things that education can do as well, but he was committed to the project of education. And there are links, big links we could make that I won't go into great detail on here, of how particularly Fanon's ideas have been taken up pedagogies for decolonization. So William Pienaar, who's also a queer theorist, talks about the need to reconstruct one's own subjectivity, extricating oneself psychologically from interpolation by the colonial regime, in which he says, for Fanon, there could be no collective possibility without subjective and social reconstruction. So this project to reconnect and a transformative project that links the psychic and the social is very much on the agenda. And that there are indeed other decolonization theorists who critique Freire and prefer Fanon precisely because of the need to avoid that psychologization. And alongside that, Rubén Gastambide Fernández talks about three kinds of solidarity. And the solidarity here, that's important because it's not about identification and it's not about certainties, and it is about creating new forms of relationship, alliances as constitutive. With fantasized qualities are therefore important. But what I've been talking about here is the less pleasant kinds of identification, including those kinds of forms of commitment or attachment that fuel racist and nationalist projects, the throne and altar in Freud's words. But more broadly speaking, the project here is to attend to affective modalities that open possibilities of questioning our kinds of commitments and identifications and destabilizing them to be able to think more critically about them. So to move towards a conclusion now, I've been suggesting that configurations of children and childhood abound in our daily lives and that attending to the claims that are made for and about children and childhoods could be thought of as a practice of this approach I'm calling child as method, and can be a way in to analyse what's going on in those wider debates. So child as method isn't only about analysing children, it's about looking at the role that children play within broader sets of social practices. And so I see it as a critical and politically transformative practice that also works to counter and resist one of the very problematic things that happens with any kind of discussion in children and childhood, is that the child is plucked from its socio-political, cultural and economic context and treated as an entity, a separate entity on its own. And what we can see now is how that construction of the childhood relies upon those very other forces that it is up in conventional representations abstracted from. So in that sense, we can understand the construction of the child as functioning in very powerful ways in those wider socio-political relations. So constructions of childhood not only serve certain kinds of socio-psychological functions, but we need to know more about those in order to contest them and to change them. And I've been talking about how generational, gendered, and racialized ideas underlie claims to differential entitlements, who's allowed to be here and not be here, for example, inform the dynamics of othering that the child is one example of, but also is implicated in producing for others. So I'm suggesting then that child as method, as a practice of deconstructive reading, I've been offering you a reading of Manoni's account, and of teaching, because we can talk and debate and discuss this, is a contribution to trying to generate a pedagogy of and for decolonization and of redistribution. And just to finish with another example, oh no, what's this? Yeah, sorry, two slides too soon. So it's a bridge then, yeah. It's a bridge between childhood studies and educational theory. So what I'm suggesting here is that child as method can help us think more about what we're doing with and around notions of childhood within educational practices, how educational practices function within cultural political practices, and also helping us to think about how the trope of the child can be mobilized, can be used as an anti-colonial lens with which to read educational practices. And now finally, the last example to finish with is one that I'm sure you'll have you'll recognize all too well. So just a couple of weeks ago, we had this on our screens. So Professor Robert Kelly, in the 10th of March, interviewed by the BBC, and his children appear as he's doing this Skype interview from Busan in South Korea. And the interviewer says, excuse me, your children, can you do something, or what, something going on here? And this became, an internet sensation. He was oblivious at first. And then this woman appears and grabs hold of the children and takes them back. And, this was really quite a sensation for a moment on the internet, wasn't it? One of the interesting things is that, we could say that the children's disruption follows the structure of a joke, permitting expression of forbidden and dangerous pleasures. So in the discussion, after everybody enjoying this quite a lot, having to interrogate their own responses, there was some reflection in the across the media about the racism of the gender and power assumptions that have been made. So that why did so many people assume that the BBC's professor's wife was his maid? And from The Guardian, if you saw a nanny in this BBC interview, what does that say about you? But you see, nobody really said anything about the naturalized position of the child. In the media coverage, there's all this, lots of descriptions about the children, actually, there's two of them, isn't there? As gate crashing, show stealing, hilarious, adorable, as embarrassing the father, red-faced, he was red-faced and mortified. And that made him, in terms of the structure of a joke, it made you could say, the expert, the professor, the boffin, the talking head, kind of ordinary. Accessible in a way, and seemed to be a lot of concern about what was he wearing. Was he wearing pajama bottoms? And it's really, I think it says something about sexuality that drives some of this as well. But of course, what it does is, it, in a way, it distanced us for a moment from the more serious, dreadful news that was going on. It was seen as enjoyable. It was the viral video of the week that made millions smile. But there's a naturalization of the child here. So his father says they're little kids and that's how things are. But what's so interesting is the sense that he made a mistake. Mr. Kelly, so mistakes are the theme of this talk. Mr. Kelly, don't call him professor, that's interesting too, had made a fatal mistake. He forgot to lock his study door. And this is where I'm going to end. It seems that cute children who are, gate crashing and adorable, children don't do politics, but politics is done through and with them. Thank you.
Well, I'm delighted to be here. I'm just going to speak for about 5 minutes, to and after Erica's lecture, and then open up to questions to the floor. So I'm delighted to be here, and also I'm very honoured to be here to respond to such a rich and thought-provoking lecture. I think this second Sarah Fielding's lecture about Erica is the best way for us to celebrate the launch of the third edition of Deconstructing Developmental Psychology. And I think one of the reasons why I think is the best way to celebrate this is because it really builds on the work that book has done in its three re-edition. And I think the lecture really shows us what can be done by combining the various frameworks that emerge from that book that really helps us to think about the role of a discipline and at the same time what is at stake for that discipline with this new framework that Erica is now developing, the child as method. And it seems to me very clear that what Erica's lecture achieves is twofold. Firstly, to my mind, it critiques in a sense of it analyzes, we could say even dissects, the complex ways in which childhood is a construction that works within wider political psychic economies. And you know, I think it's crucial to think about the complexity of that construction. So on the one hand, it does that kind of analyzing, dissecting work, but also it creates a space, it opens up a space for new critical pedagogies. So crucial to that first point, that more kind of analytical, I'm for the sake of argument, I'm dividing these achievements into two main points, but as we've seen from the lecture, the two are constantly interconnected. But to me, crucial to that first point is the way in which the child is not crystallized as something that works as other, you know, to the adult, for instance, or to society, or outside society, or as the natural. So it's not even recruited just as a kind of, oh, we can't accept that. But it seems to me to, you know, and that's why I'm thinking about complexity being key, that the lecture really showed us how different and sometimes contradictory are the roles that are assigned to the child. And this is not just something that changes in history or changes according to political configurations or geographical locations, but actually there is a certain kind of malleability of the figure of the child that seems to be crucial to, you know, how hard it is to analyze it. And, you know, this dynamic model in Erica's lecture is very important, I think. And, you know, related to the second point, you know, what I think the lecture does in terms of creating a new space for critical pedagogies, it seems to me that it's important, again, to think about how Erica's work doesn't really establish a new set of rules, which, if applied, would give us finally a kind of new appropriate kind of child, or you know, a set of, you know, educational or pedagogical regulations or structures that will actually produce the desired effect. And I think this is also, again, speaks to kind of complexity of the issue at hand, but it opens up this reflective space where we have always to reflect on our own position when we are thinking about the child, looking at the child, looking at us, looking at the child. Okay, so this opening up can be sometimes be also quite hard to bear. That kind of self-reflective space is also quite difficult, quite hard to bear very often. And perhaps the kind of third point that I want to tease out of this, you know, very rich lecture is how the lecture also traces, as we've seen, Erica's trajectory from psychology, and more specifically developmental psychology, to childhood studies and education. But it also traces for us a line of continuity, something that links Erica's work in all these fields very, very clearly, and that is the attention to what has been called on this occasion the framework or the method. Okay, and I'm thinking here about Erica's book when, towards the end, the book claims, for instance, you know, it's interesting that previous editions of the book have been read in different ways, and some of the readings have, you know, interpreted the book as being almost against developmental psychology, and in this edition Erica makes a point about saying, well, this is not a book that goes against developmental psychology, quite the opposite. Is a book that looks at, you know, one main preoccupation or one main set of preoccupations within developmental psychology, but also looks at the role that developmental psychology has within the discipline, the function that developmental psychology has within the wider discipline of psychology, and the responsibilities that come with that role. So there, you know, what is very interesting, I think, about this third edition is also the way in which there is an emphasis on the reflection on the framework,
of developmental psychology as such. And similarly, it seems to me, there's a line of continuity in this lecture, because this kind of work on the child as method, but also via the child as method, looks not so much at identifying the child as a definite object of study, but at making it quite dynamic, quite mobile, quite, you know, I hesitate perhaps to claim flexibility given the kind of neoliberal association that that work seems to have, but, you know, looks both at the child as something definitely not easy to pin down, but also at the ideas about and commitments to children. So it does exactly in that, you know, same way that the book on developmental psychology does, you know, looks at the object of study, but also at the discipline as the formation of the discipline, and it manages to do two things at once, which I think is fairly extraordinary, really. And so the whole idea of like our investment as researchers in the discipline that we engage with, not just in the object that we're looking at, seems to me to be the kind of red thread throughout the whole of Erica's work, and, you know, still, you know, very much present in new, exciting ways in this lecture. So I do have lots of questions, actually more specific about some of the arguments germane today, but perhaps, you know, my 5 minutes, you know, tuppence worth, you know, have allowed you to kind of come up with your questions, and I've said that I would fill the questions, and Erica's very kindly going to accept questions today. So if there are any questions, now is the time.
Comments, debates,
absolutely anything.
Conversations across the room, departures, themes taken.
No, I think you should have this back, shouldn't you?
Share it, but
I think you have it.
Actually, there's a question. Are people okay with this being filmed, or would you rather not? Yeah, okay. Well, if you could carry on, Peter, yeah.
Well, why don't I start with one question, and then that might give everyone else a little bit more time. I mean, one of the things that I was really interested in is the idea of deception, but also the idea of recognition of that deception, you know, and the kind of, you know, what kind of role does truth have in Manoni's argument, but also in your argument, you know, that idea of like an objective deception of the child that comes up towards the end, but also towards the beginning, the idea that, you know, there's a recognition of that deception. And I'm thinking about a recent piece by Alenka Dzupancic, someone who's also very interested in psychoanalysis, although in a different field. And she did this very interesting analysis of a French film called The Boss of It All. And she looks at how this film, which is very much about the kind of the workplace and this guy who's pretending to be the boss of this company, pretends to be a middle manager, but he's actually the boss of the company. So he can drive through all sorts of unpopular restructuring in the workplace because it says, oh, well, it's the big boss that wants it, it's not me. And he tries to be the kind of caring face of management. Well, you know, all the blame is elsewhere, you know, a situation that we're very familiar with, I suppose. But what Zupanchis is interested in is to say, okay, there's a moment, a kind of twist in the film where everything is revealed and people realize that actually he was the boss altogether, and that doesn't change anything, you know? So sort of like, you know, now we know, but still, you know, the structure is not changed. So I'm just thinking about how that idea of deception kind of works when you're so interestingly in this lecture also thinking about, you know, the Brexit, you know, narrative about all the same still, you know, I'm still occupying that position, you know, so to where the kind of moment of revelation doesn't seem to make that, you know, political change, doesn't seem to kind of jerk things and, you know, even in a perhaps undesirable direction, doesn't seem to do very much, actually.
Oh, my goodness. Well, my mind's going in lots of different directions at once, but I think the, you know, when Manoni says the child is objectively deceived, it's not a statement about truth, it's a statement about relationships, isn't it? And that's what I think is so valuable about the analysis, because, you know, one of the things about racism, and particularly the psychological theories about prejudice, and these assumptions, if you just provide the correct information, people say, yes, and then it's all goes. And it's the persistence. So the boss being revealed as being the big boss doesn't make any difference, because perhaps they kind of knew anyway, but they didn't want to know. But anyway, maybe they thought it and now it's confirmed. Mm-hmm. But there's no way of dislodging that, and in a way, there's no way back. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, I can see how that is a precise exemplification of I know well, but all the same. Yeah. But the quest, yeah, and I don't think, I think that shows that truth, the truth is a situated construction, that it, you know, that the truth might change historically, and our relationship to it is then mediated in certain kinds of ways that rely on our desires not to know.
Yeah.
And not, so they might have suspected that he was, but they didn't want to think so.
In the case perhaps of your example with the kind of, I don't know, Father Christmas example,
yeah,
there is also that kind of thrill, isn't there? That kind of, like, you know, adult thrill about knowing and witnessing the credulity and sort of like reflecting on one's power as well. So again, the kind of relationality comes back. Yeah. Questions? Yes?
I wondered how kind of social codes and practices around protection of children fit in with the analysis of the human area. I was thinking there was a section of transcripts where parents unwrapping a sweet talks about the racist by children, and he said, it's the parents who are to blame.
Yes.
And my interpretation of that was of this person potentially doing that in a protective way. Actually, he thought the children perhaps had significant agency in it and actually might be to blame.
Yeah.
But actually, his discourse was a discourse that was protective for the parents. So it wasn't that he was denying the children's agency of what happened.
Mm.
It was more that it kind of isn't fair social game to blame the children. He seems to have got a positive voice, you know, about where the kind of the kind of racist behaviour leads, and we know where it goes to. And I wondered if, you know,
That was a different interviewee saying that, but Peter.
But, you know, nevertheless, I just wondered about how these notions of protection, and particularly for us as educational researchers, and the kind of codes around the protection of children in terms of what we reveal and don't reveal, how that fits in with analysis.
Well, yes, I think it does reveal something, that a lot of what we're doing in the name of protecting children is protecting ourselves, and it has very little to do with children. I think that's one of the key things. Naz is nodding here, so she works in child protection, so you might want to come back on this too. And in this little extract, I would want to look at the work done by that shift from kids to children, for example. That they're just children, but, you know, the social force, the force carried by kids is much more politically ambivalent than but children must be innocent, and are made innocent, I found helpful in Manoni is that unremitting interrogation of what's at stake in creating that place of innocence for children, which, you know, is so exclusionary for so many children, as well as very oppressive, as well as very, you know, it fulfills some sort of convenient projects for
for us as adults to put the innocence there. So I think in that sense, there are some kind of consequences for thinking through about those ideas about what we're doing in the name of protecting children.
I immediately think, you know, I immediately think of, you know, in the current kind of neoliberal climate of education, I mean, it wouldn't be too hard to construct a picture of children as kind of neoliberal foot soldiers in the competitive classroom, and of, you know, furthering the you know, kind of acquisitive desires of their family interests. You know, I mean, it wouldn't be difficult to kind of head in that direction as a researcher.
And
I'm, you know, just part of me feeling, I mean, we kind of don't go there. And I, you know, I wonder about
strikes up and doing your summer for Britain in the Thames and Pisa Wars. That's exactly what he said. That's exactly what he did. Doing your sums for Britain was the the title of the paper and subtitles.
But you know, there's been discussions around being pushing
it.
And you know, parents have kind of haven't been protected. You know, discourses about teachers not resisting and not opposing. Discourses around policymakers pursuing aggressive. You know, I'm not withstanding.
I mean, and there are, and there's but the difficulty in resisting, well, there's so many minefields around the sort of narrations and iterations of forms of childhood, from, because as soon as you start, I mean, of course we all want to resist, you know, accelerating children into mini adults in some form, but then we have to think why and in what ways, and what are we installing in its place, and then the kind of all the whole stolen childhood discourse kind of reinstalls a kind of normative typical childhood that is actually, I think, you know, very, very unhelpful. You know, it fulfills a place for us as adults in thinking there was a place called childhood, but it's not the place that children live, I think. And so it's not to say that I could know what we would put in its place. That's not the deconstructive project. It's more to look at what's being done through certain formulations, and what's being privileged, what's being warded off, etc.
But I'm also thinking about the lecture was also trying to say, okay, let's never look at childhood in isolation. I suppose to me the first thing that, you know, springs to mind is the heightened levels of anxiety in the UK about selective education, for instance, and the kind of, you know, the pushing through, you know, kind of renewed grammar school, so that every parent is supposed to be a pushy parent, every parent is supposed to already secretly, you know, subscribe to the fact that, you know, if you really nudge and push enough, then yours will be the one picked up, you know, for better funded education. So I think the kind of, you know, that to me also seems something that comes out of not looking just at the child as an individual, but as a kind of, I don't know, kind of slightly wider, you know, network, you know, which, yeah, it's anxiety ridden these days, I think. I think there's a question.
Sophie, yeah.
That was brilliant. Thank you so much for such a good lecture. I was sort of thinking to myself about, I was wondering if you could say perhaps a bit more about the content of our messaging to children about racism, because I was wondering about the implicit racial position perhaps of the adult who tells herself, let's say herself, I don't know, that she or we protect children from the reality of racism, because I'm not sure that I'm thinking of the literatures that kind of dispute the idea that perhaps there even is in some societies such a thing as a non-white child. And I'm thinking about whether it's true that children in non-white communities are protected in that way from the realities of racism, and whether parenting sometimes requires, for the purposes of survival, quite a quite the opposite, really. Quite an education about the real of racism in some context. So I don't know if that's really particularly relevant to your lecture, but it's something that arose nonetheless. I don't know if you could comment on.
Well, I mean, there might be other people in the room who will be far better qualified to take up that that particular question, because it's not one I was looking at the ways in which the child secures certain ideological beliefs and commitments, including racism, but the whole question of children's understanding and awareness of racism and parental strategies and educational strategies in relation to that is, you know, those huge debates and literatures. And Susie and I are also doing some work on supplementary schooling, partly, you know, in thinking about what function these educational spaces that are not part of mainstream schooling fulfill. And some of them are about doing your sums. And some of them are about kind of feeling better about yourself, and some of them about learning the language of your parents formally, or studying the religion. And so they're very diverse. So it would be very difficult to make compose a general answer to that kind of question, even in terms of, you know, empirical practice, because the analytical field is so complex. But I think I want to return to this point that Danny highlighted, really. What my project in this paper is to resist that abstraction of the child, and so I'm, you know, to show how that abstraction it does certain kind of key work. And what we need to look at is the shifting relational kind of, not flexible, but sort of shifting and relational positioning, without having to say what the child is, because then we're falling into the trap of doing that same thing again. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah. I'm just thinking about not abstracting the child. I mean, you can't just talk about race without thinking about the intersections. And I'm just picking up the way you interwove the intersectionality bit, because let's say there does exist a community where there are all black children and there are no white children. Is that the construction that you
I'm just thinking of things I've read about perhaps black parenting, in which the idea that there's protection of the child from racism might not be right, because that's not necessarily what parenting.
Because the parenting of that black child will also be about its gender, about its class, about all kinds of things, sort of about things around sexual violence, things around, all kinds of things that will intersect in terms of the child's identity. And then all the myths around that, which all intersect as well, don't they?
Sure.
Because I'm thinking about the examples about we know, but at the same time, in terms of the big revelations about sexual violence, big revelations about abuse, but at the same time, we can't even get someone to chair a committee. At the same time, we still don't believe. At the same time, we think what happened in Rochdale is to do with the fact that there were Asian men, not at the same time, but therefore. It just abounds, doesn't it, really? But there has to be an intersectional approach to it, just like you can't abstract the child from the adult from society, you can't abstract just race or whatever.
But just thinking about the back of your point, it's not about what you do with a child, because off the back of very good research, I'm looking into exactly that, and it's a function the child plays in perpetuating essentially racism in policy. So the purpose of the child isn't looking at the child being racist, it's about how the child is used to perpetuate racist discourse and gender discourse within our policy. So there's a function of the child, not to the child, if that makes sense. The child's already been abused. That's already been done to the child in an individual relational sense, but it's what we're doing as a society, looking at phenomenon kind of concepts of this psychic injury caused by political discourses, because we're creating this thing in the child and adults and going, we have to teach women to speak English because that's how we protect children from being abused. Mm-hmm. Quote from the policy.
Yeah. Mm. So there are a couple of other.
Yes.
So it's one here and one here. What, don't know who's first.
Yeah, yeah, I don't know who's first.
Shall I go first?
Sure.
I remember growing up, and I'm very close to my mother, I think Erica knows that already, where my mother would specifically use me to, well, what she would do is state a fact or opinion and specifically blame me for it. And now I think it was a legitimate thing for her to do, but she didn't have the power or the feelings that she had the power or the right to be able to express her own opinion. So I think there's an idea of social justice behind here as well. However, I do think it was an important thing for her to do now on reflection, because every child does grow up and they then do question the belief that the child, that the parents have been force-feeding them to be able to rebel. So there's maybe an important role there. No child carries on believing in Santa. Is there a role there? Is it a legitimate thing to do? That's what I'm really asking.
Well, no child carries on believing in Santa and then has some pleasure in other children being deceived. I mean, that would be Manoni's, the Freudian analysis. But you've just turned that around. And I think that's very interesting, the idea that you can now... I mean, I don't know if you can remember how you felt as a child being in the place of your mother.
I didn't say mother. Yeah. Why are you doing that? You know, it used to be in private, but the older and more confident I got, I used to do it better than that.
Yeah.
That's totally wrong, I didn't say that, but probably last week she did it last time.
but that shows how you could, you know, the positions in relation to, I mean, you know, legitimation, who's the legitimate speaker is one of the things that you're kind of alluding to. And if she, yeah, and your... the resentment of being put in that position you can now see in another way, and
exactly.
I think that's very interesting. Yeah. and whether as children we can look back on those kinds of deceptions and understand why that was done to us and arrive at another position in relation to those myths that we were made to subscribe to for others is I think an open and interesting question.
Okay, thank you very much for your presentation. I wanted to ask you about what, in your opinion, are the implications for teachers or for educational research in relation to dealing with these two concepts of raising a kid with neutral ideas, but dealing with the issue of like, developing his or her identity. What is the role of teachers or educators in that sense, in your opinion?
Well, I don't think anything I've said today really would really lead to any particular answer to that question. But clearly, we as parents, as educators, in a range of environments, and adults who encounter children have major responsibilities in that regard. I mean, it depends what you mean by identities. But of course, that's what we're doing all the time. And even when we think we're not doing it, we're also doing it, because that's what one of the implications, I suppose, of my analysis here. But there may be other people in the room who want to respond specifically. Because your question is about what particularly we should be doing.
What is the role? What can we do to help kids or students in general to develop help them develop their own identity, but with a neutral view, or I don't know if that's the right word, not biased by this the contingency, as you mentioned, like everything that's going on in the world.
Well, I suppose I would. I mean, insofar as anything I've said has kind of could be mobilized to respond to that particular question, first of all, I would say there's no position without bias. We have to own and acknowledge the particularity of our own position and understand that those children's positions is also similarly situated, equivalently, and to make that quite explicit. Insofar as we can, and we can't do it completely. That's the other bit of the pedagogy of failure, that we can't do it completely. But we can try, and we can make those apparent
those entities that seem beyond question, we can render them questionable. Things that can be spoken of and discussed. And in that sense, then that child, young person, student, is enabled, equipped with the critical and relational skills to make up their own minds in dialogue with, hopefully, communities of practice of others who would also support that kind of process. I think that's our responsibility as parents and educators. I don't know if anyone...
Yeah, I totally agree with everything you were saying about what we should do, but I think importantly it's not just about having these ideas necessarily just discussed, which implies a very rational and linguistic approach, but I would say sort of experimented with and kind of pushed and experimented with what happens if we, as teachers and educators, to create this kind of situation where children can experiment with different alternatives and different realities. And I think there was a quote from Fanon exactly about that earlier. I think definitely discussing them explicitly is important, but also this place of experimenting, this understanding that these are not sort of immutable traits within the child, but are the things that that we impose for different reasons and also impose on us. So through this position of childhood allows different positions of adulthood and you know, through this imagination of childhood as the place of fun and play and we are angry about parents who push children too hard to be too competitive, we are legitimizing it didn't spill. It's good. We are legitimizing this super competitive adult world because we had that space of childhood, and now we're in the space of adulthood. And I think that was one of the things that was most demonstrated in the Kelly video, and this kind of discussion of why do you blame him for being a chauvinist? He's only trying to be professional. Being professional means not having kids and not playing, and that's it. There's no question about
it. Well, thank you for that response.
I think there is another question next, isn't there? Was there a question? No?
Yes. Okay.
Can I?
Yes, sure.
I don't
know what it is.
Response, comment, great.
It is something. this thing just reminded me of a sketch by Mitchell Webb, where at some point, if somebody goes to the bank, and at some point he tells him to get an investment, and at some point he wants to sell, he wants the bank to participate, give them a loan to start a business in selling drugs to children. And he tells the banker, well, either you believe in market forces or you don't. And then the banker tells him the story of him being a child and hearing his parents downstairs talking about there is no market forces. And the whole Santa thing kind of reminded me. But I think it's kind of those two sort of actions. But I would also make kind of a response. I don't know if it's a response. I would want to hear your response, really, about how should we think about the relationship between, say, these kind of concessions, the social concessions that we kind of exceptionalize from society, and statements like boys will be boys, or this is just locker room talk, and so on. I mean, we can think of many others, which are not as temporal as childhood is, you say.
No, but I think they're subject to exactly the same kind of analysis. They have to be. I mean, as soon as anyone makes those kind of general those claims, like, you know, Robert Kelly saying, well, they're just children, you know, my hackles rise, boys will be boys. Well, what on earth does that mean? But we think, you know, it functions so powerfully. It's one of these banalities that the truisms, the cliches, you know, and precisely that's that performs a function that it doesn't apparently say.
It goes beyond what the words say in the meanings that are set in motion. It's just locker room talk or what is that's the deniability that maintains the same practice in a way that I think is. It's like I was only joking, which gets all those meanings in circulation, but then you can retract responsibility for them. But they wouldn't work as a joke unless those meanings were already available to be mobilised, and then, you know, responsibility for having reactivated them then denied. So the locker room talk couldn't function without the locker room, I suppose, and all that goes with it. Yeah.
Anxious about this idea of the child being objectively deceived and whether that others them as rather prejudiced. And I was just thinking back to, you know, if you want to tell somebody a lie, you tell them something they want to hear. And so there's a kind of transactional gameplay in Father Christmas, tooth fairies, and things. And perhaps more, I was thinking about, I was brought up a Catholic as a child. My sort of belief about all these things I was told was very conditional. So I just wonder if it's sort of about this idea of objective deceit.
No, I think you're right. I think it, you know, these things are all relative. I mean, I think, and maybe that was Manoni's moment of slipping into some kind of romance of the natural child when he said that. But there is a different. You know, when we enter the social order, we are subject to certain ready-made cultural frameworks, aren't we? That we haven't played as active a part in making as those that are, you know, as the others who create our worlds for and with us, even if we interact with them, even if we know that we'll maintain our parents' religious belief by going along looking like we believe it, in the tooth fairy, very relevant example, I suppose. But yes, I mean, I think one would want to kind of deconstruct that objective, subjective deception and see it as much more nuanced. Otherwise, you're denying children's, you know, agentic kind of capacity for meaning making and social participation. So, I think it does identify at least a range of positionings that could be laid out to think about. If that's an adequate answer. I think probably we should. Is
there one more? Oh. Shall we say last question?
Thank you. It's just recently I've been in a situation I was talking to. I had a teacher recently, and you know, they were talking about the school, the volume school that has been recently where, what's happened there, but there's been some issue between head teacher and the video of the teachers who rebelled against the head teacher. We've all seen that volume school in Trafford. I was talking to a head teacher recently, and who knows, they were saying, and I was just saying, what's dreadful, isn't it? Because there've been careers wrecked there, there've been, you know, those teachers' lives, it's just a small thing, and it's been taken up by the media. So we're having a chat, and he said, and it was kind of like a strap line, said, and of course, the people who've been affected most by this are the children. And I always just say, well, actually, I'm not sure we
see it. Yeah, not sure that's true.
Say it, because. And it's one of those phrases that it's untouchable, then it becomes crystallised, and then it becomes an absolute, and you can't problematise, you can't question it. And so these dropping phrases, which are about the children, just become a discourse that you can't then query.
Yes.
And I just thought that was quite interesting.
Yes. There's a Simpson meme, isn't there? But, you know, what about the children? Kind of, you know. Yeah. And it just performs something that closes down further discussion because it is so absolute. But, you know, what that belies, as you're saying, is the whole political economy in which that structure of childhood functions as jobs for others, of, you know, in all kinds of roles, positions, relationships, interpersonally, institutionally, as well as sort of you know, much more broadly in terms of national identity and so on. And thank you for that example, and couldn't agree more.
I think that we may want to join me in thanking Eric again for such a wonderful.